You're listening to Beyond Bossfights, gaming conversations with interesting people. Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 4. This is Brax Wolf. Glad to have you with us. Today we're going to get a little bit right-brained on you. We're going to get a little bit artistic. That's because we're talking about Machinima. Machinima being using a video game to create some kind of video or movie. Using the video game as kind of the engine that drives that creative process. And within the LOTRO community, we have several people who kind of dabble in Machinima and put it out on YouTube, but one in particular sticks out to me because I'm familiar with him through LOTRO players, and that is Pash, the creative genius behind An Unexpected Vidcast, which, if I was to explain it to you, if you're not familiar with it, I guess the only way I could kind of explain An Unexpected Vidcast is that it's kind of like a variety show. You never really know exactly what's going to be on it. A lot of times it will have your standard store news, and it'll talk about people who donated to LOTRO players because it's part of the LOTRO player site. But other than that, it's kind of a guessing game, which you're going to get on An Unexpected Vidcast, hence the name. Sometimes he has deed guides, sometimes he has guest bands, sometimes he has poems. It's just this entire gamut of creative stuff that could be on this vidcast. I've always been fascinated by people with an artistic flair because I think, I don't know if I'm right about this, but I tend to differentiate creativity from artistic ability. I think that just about everybody has some kind of creative slant to what they do. I've known people who troubleshoot network problems and people who do computer code that do it in a very creative way, but I'm not sure that I would consider them artistic necessarily. Now, so when I think of artistic, I think about things like what Pash does. So I had a really good time talking to Pash about his creative process and kind of trying to get inside his head and figure out what it is that he does that makes him so successful on this Machinima stuff. Now, we do talk about Machinima a little bit. The podcast is very much focused, though, on what Pashbo does and how he taps into his creative juices. I really enjoyed the conversation. We talked about things like what he does to prepare himself to do the Unexpected Vidcast. I think you'd be surprised at how long it actually takes him to go from idea to actually getting the vidcast uploaded. We talk about how he kind of incorporates his family into some of the things he does. We talk about some of his other creative endeavors. So one of the interesting things I learned about Pash over the course of the last month or so is that he's involved in Freak Circus. And we talk a little bit about that and what this crazy punk/alternative band from South England has to do with hobbits and Machinima. We talk about some of the other ideas that Pash has for An Unexpected Vidcast in the future and kind of talk about the big question, which is there a full-length Unexpected Vidcast feature film in the future? Anyway, we've got a lot of ground to cover, so let's get into it. So today I have with me Pash. And Pash, as we do in all of my podcasts, I like to have people give their definitive gaming history so that everybody knows where they're coming from a video game standpoint, since this is a general gaming podcast. So where exactly did you start with video gaming, and what has led you into what you're doing today?
Okay, and firstly, hi Prax, and hello everyone that's listening. I'm actually old enough to remember the old ZX Spectrum and that first Hobbit game that came out, which I guess really in many ways led the way for text-based adventure games. And I used to play a lot of those type of games when I was growing up. I loved those Games Workshop fighting fantasy books. I don't know whether you had them over that side of the world or not, but
it doesn't sound familiar to me.
No, I mean, effectively it was a similar sort of adventure game to what you'd get with things like the Hobbit, where you would read a chunk of text, and then you'd get a number of questions, and you'd decide your own destiny. So effectively,
yes.
as a young lad growing up, it meant you could sort of combine reading with the ability to sort of determine your own future. So it used to be quite...
Those were called Choose Your Own Adventure books over here.
Right, okay. Yes, yeah, it's a similar sort of thing then. And I think because I sort of like the concept of Dungeons and Dragons, but I was never really felt comfortable or confident enough to just sit there and let my imagination run wild with a group of other people. So these sort of games provided quite a good alternative to that. But going back to that sort of time, I wasn't really a great gamer by any means. I didn't really sort of start getting addicted to games as such until probably I was in my early 20s, around the time when the Silent Hill franchise first came out. And I really loved those because they had that really great creepy atmosphere, but also at the same time I was never brilliant at fighting type games. I always much preferred getting into the puzzles, trying to solve things, and there was always quite a high degree of that within that particular franchise. And also the other great side of that, which I guess links in a little bit with the discussion today, is that they'd have these really great little film sequences that would appear. So, you know, it was always felt like quite an achievement when you'd get to a certain stage in that game that would then open up this brilliant little film sequence. And that really got me into a variety of those adventure type based games. So things like Shenmue, which was an old Dreamcast game, and another particular favorite was Omicron, the Nomad Soul, which is like a futuristic adventure game, which involved you walking around this futuristic city, changing your own character, and also had a lot of music within it. Used a lot of David Bowie's images within it, and I was always a big Bowie fan anyway, so I got really into that game. But aside from that, I was not always a great gamer, but when I did play them, I tend to get quite addicted to it. I remember when I was playing Silent Hill, for instance. I think it was Silent Hill 3. I remember completing the whole game in one day, rather than revising for an exam that I was meant to be sitting the next day.
There you go.
Which is really stupid. Although I did successfully blag my way through the exam, so it's all right.
I think we've all been there, though.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, that night I went to sleep, and all I could see were these sort of scary, derelict shopping precincts everywhere I went. And I still get that now, really. When I sort of overdose a bit on Lotro, I tend to sort of have dreams about everyday people with golden rings above their heads. You know? but the first MMO I got into was RuneScape, and I played that quite regularly until I sort of accidentally stumbled on Lotro, actually. I'd always been a Tolkien addict since I was a young lad, and it was like heaven, really, when I found this game where you could actually walk through Middle Earth at your own leisure. But I was totally green to the whole way that the MMOs worked. So when I left that starting area for the first time, rather than following the quest line like you were meant to, I was immediately jumping in trying to find famous locations from the book. So I was off walking around in the Midgewater marshes and wondering why I died pretty much instantly. But having said that, I guess Lotro was a lot more challenging back then as well. But
right.
I certainly didn't understand that whole concept of purple quests. But I mean, aside from Lotro, which I do spend a lot of time on, I've not really excessively played many games constantly, if you see what I mean. I just have little fads here and there.
Right, right. So you're going by Pash in this episode, and the reason is because a lot of your Lotro characters start with the Pash prefix, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit, because... Okay. There might be folks out there that are listening to you right now thinking, well, that guy's got a really good radio voice. That's not a hobbit right there. Could you please do the Poshbow voice for me just one time for this episode?
I can. I was actually initially, I had this horrible feeling when we first started talking about doing this that you might want me to do the whole of the podcast in the Poshbow voice, which would be quite difficult. But I'm going to go for it right now, okay?
All right.
Hello, Poshbow Proudfeet here.
It's really you. I'm not convinced.
It is really me, yeah.
Well, thanks for being on. And our topic today... this is also kind of a funny little story. Our topic today is Machinima.
Yeah.
And Machinima, I didn't know this term when I first heard it probably about, I don't know, three months ago. And Scudo Dragon Slayer on Lotro Players did some kind of a video in Lotro, and he called it Machinima. And I went, I don't know what that is. So I went and looked it up, and apparently it's kind of a mashup word between machine and cinema. So it basically means you take some kind of piece of a video game, you record it, and then you edit it into some kind of a cinema movie type creative thing, right?
Yep.
And then the funny thing was I approached you about this topic, and you said, yeah, it sounds good, but I don't know what it means.
Yeah. I was quickly sort of there on Google trying to find out, because I thought, well, maybe this is just something that everybody else knows about, not me. I'm missing out. Little did I know that I was actually doing it myself to some degree.
So I did a little bit of research on it, and obviously Machinima is now a company that does YouTube affiliations, but that's capital M Machinima. Small M Machinima is something that was around quite a while ago. In fact, I stumbled upon an old Wired magazine post from 2003. And this was done by Leander Cani, and he's talking about kind of the emergence of this Machinima thing. And he says, however, Machinima is maturing so rapidly, some predict it will soon be a major force in animation, especially with the imminent arrival of a new generation of hardware and software, promising an era of photorealistic cinematic computing. And then he goes on to say, Machinima filmmakers are also using so-called massively multiplayer online games, such as EverQuest or The Dark Age of Camelot, and that kind of dates the article, to make real-time movies. The game's Dungeons & Dragons environments are the sets, and different players log in over the internet to control the characters. Now they're explaining what MMOs are. A host PC is hooked to a VCR or camcorder, and the action is recorded as it unfolds. So apparently this is something that was being done back when VCRs were in vogue.
Yeah. And actually, to be honest, I'm probably using what was then high-tech equipment even now.
Exactly. Yeah. So we're going to get to kind of what has happened to Machinima since it was supposedly a major force back in 2003. But I wanted to start off with a little bit of history first and a little bit of what you do and where you've come from. So could you tell us what exactly is An Unexpected Vidcast and what gave you the idea for it?
Yeah, sure. I'll actually start with the second part of that question because it's probably easiest. But a number of years back, I thought when I first started playing Lotro, actually, I thought it would be quite fun to actually replicate the journey that Frodo made, but in game, and write a blog about it each day, accompanied by screenshots. So I'd been a fan of Tolkien's work, as I said earlier, since I was about 7, 8. And as a teenager, I bought a book of maps called The Journeys of Frodo, which was written by Barbara Strachan, and she'd sort of hand-drawn all of the maps based on the text. So she, within that, she mapped out Frodo's journey on a day-by-day basis, and I thought that'd be fantastic to use that as source material and basically try to replicate that journey as far as possible on the in-game maps. The challenge at that time was I only had one hobbit, which was Pashbow, and he was one of the first ones I'd set up, this little grey-haired hobbit burglar on the Gilrain server, but I really struggled with the burglar class. I couldn't get my head around it. And he was only level 10, and I was conscious of the fact that following this timeline, I'd have to get to this stage where he was going to be walking into Moria. So I had to level him quite quickly. But I actually got to really love him, actually, and I really got to love the burglar class. So I still have a real soft spot for Pashbow now. But this blog, it worked quite well actually, and it got some good feedback by American Golden Star on CSTM. They occasionally would sort of catch up with where I was on this little blog, and I decided after I'd finished it, it'd be quite a good idea to redo that journey in a future year. And I did it a second year in terms of a blog with a slightly wider audience, but then I thought it'd be interesting to try it in a different direction and actually capture it as a video diary, and that way it would give a closer replication in many ways of the journey. So that was initially what I was planning on doing, and I was going to just upload probably on a daily basis the journeys of Pashbo. But then when CSTM announced that they were stopping doing their podcast, and before I knew about the plans for Lotro Players News, I toyed with the idea of doing a podcast myself. But rather than it being me in it, I thought it would be more fun, because you know, nobody would want to listen to this voice when they could hear a nice squeaky voice like Pashbo. So it'd be far more fun to actually have the actual characters in game presenting it. And I thought you could follow a similar format to how CSTM successfully worked, with sort of updates on what I'd been doing, a little bit around news, a little bit around store news, that sort of thing. But that turned out to be quite a short-lived plan, and I think. In actual fact, you know, Lotro Players News does it far better than I'd have been able to do it. And also, I guess it would have also logistically, it probably would have been quite challenging. So I still like the idea of producing some kind of weekly show using in-game characters. And as always, I'd always been a keen writer, so I'd always written a lot of poems, a lot of stories, and a lot of songs. So I figured it might be a good idea to actually base a sort of weekly show on those instead, particularly as I'm a really sort of notorious altaholic. You know, I've got about somewhere between about 60 or 70 characters over various different servers. So I thought I had enough characters to quite easily provide a quite good variety of stories and segments. I was also keen that it would be something that would involve the community. So I've tried where possible to always feature some of the great bands that we've got across the various servers, and I'm always as keen as ever really to try and attend various community events, and even for people to be sort of sending me videos that they'd like me to include. You know, I'd love that. So, you know, going back to your original question of what is an unexpected vidcast, it tends to really be whatever stuff I sort of fancy showing in any one week. So it could be a deed guide, it could be a poem, it could be a stand-up comic or something based around Lord of the Rings Middle-earth lore. And that content's usually as unexpected to me as anyone else, really, because until I put it together on a Sunday. So it just tends to be whatever really comes out of my brain.
Is that where the title comes from?
Yeah, indeed. I mean, it was, you know, obviously a play on the opening chapters, but that's really where it came from. I just thought, whilst it's pretty expected, it's going to come out on a Sunday. Usually, the actual content within it tends to be, as I say, whatever's working for me on that particular day.
Do you write all of the poems that show up in the Unexpected Vidcast yourself?
I do, yeah. Usually on that Sunday morning. So.
Wow, that's pretty good.
But I've always been able to do that, to be honest. You know, I'm far better at writing, certainly, than I am speaking, as you'll find as we go on through this podcast. But I've always found it very easy just to be able to bounce words straight out of my brain onto a bit of paper, and quite soon have a story or a poem. And I tend to pretty much write it as I go along, and the final product won't be too far different from where I'd, you know, from my first take on it.
And the reason I was a little taken aback by that was that they seem to be, and I've watched a lot of your episodes, the poems are very different styles a lot of times. You have a very serious one told by your elf, I forget his name, Pash. Pashrindir?
He's one of the Pashes, yeah, Pashrindir.
Pashrindir, yeah. The elf. Well, usually tells very serious poems. And then you have a little limerick done by a hobbit dancing around a campfire. So it's just quite a broad range there, too.
Yeah, and that tends to be how I work. I think if it's something which is a lot more serious, I tend to usually focus that on one of my on the elf. If it's something a bit more jovial, then that tends to go down as a hobbit poem. But it's good fun. It's, as I say, there's no real great planning. It's just whatever I'm thinking at the time, which probably says as much as anything else about the way that my mind works.
How many different characters do you voice in the show?
Well, as I said, I've got over 60 literary characters that I've got, but not all of them have yet featured in the vidcast. But who knows? They may do as time goes on. But in terms of regular characters, I think it's about 16 characters. But the main focus tends to be around Pashbo, that I talked about earlier on, and Chumley, who isn't a Pash, but I've always had he's one of my main Laurelin characters, so heavily involved in a lot of the roleplay stuff over there. And I've got a soft spot for him as well.
Now, you mentioned Chumley. If I remember right, Chumley was the MC in charge of the big burrow.
He wasn't. No, that was I'm trying to remember. I've got so many Pashes, I can't remember which one's which. That was Pashko. Pashko was the big burrow.
Okay. Yeah. I didn't want it to let this entire episode pass without at least mentioning the big burrow, because I know that that was a very popular segment. And in fact, I think it came out in Lotra Players News episode once or twice that even my kids were coming down and asking me if they could watch the Unexpected Vidcast every week.
That's right, yeah.
That segment just really hooked people in, and it was just a great play on the Big Brother concept, where you threw a bunch of different Tolkien races into a hobbit burrow, and each one got voted out by people who watched the episode. So you actually had a poll every week for the audience, right?
And it's funny, actually, because when I had the idea for that initially, I wasn't sure necessarily whether that would work, because, I mean, Big Brother's very big over here. That reality TV stuff is very big over here. But I wasn't sure to what extent people would be able to associate with that in other countries as well. But it seemed to work pretty good. The only downside of it is, once we got to the end of it, it was quite a hard act to follow up in many ways. So still trying to get people engaged in what I was doing with the vidcast now that Big Burrow had finished. My son's already nagging me, actually, to bring it back again this year. But I don't know. I think if we do it, I think we'll have to do it sort of quite differently to keep it fresh.
Well, they always put a twist in, right? There's some kind of twist.
Yeah, but something I was thinking about possibly was a similar sort of thing, but inviting involvement of characters from the sort of wider Locho community. So basically getting other people's characters all within this one big burrow, but film a whole load of footage and then let viewers decide each week who's staying in and work on a segment around that. But we'll see. That's probably a little bit, it might be one of these things that's difficult to achieve. But
that would
you've got to think big.
Yeah, that would be very interesting. And I think you're right, very difficult to do.
Yeah, well, I had this brilliant idea for the Christmas edition. I had these big plans of actually recording this multi-character version of Feed the World, which I do you know that over there, the Band-Aid song? Yeah. And it was going to be set in Frostbluff, but involve all of the characters that have ever been in the vidcast all singing a little bit of it. And I thought it was going to be fantastic. And if I could have pulled it off, it would have been great. But I just couldn't work out how to get the ABC files or anything like that working to get it to work. But
sounds like it would take about 6 months worth of planning to get something like that.
Yeah, that's right. That's the problem. See, that's why I'm better off if I just think of things on the day. Because the more time I have to think about these things, the ideas get grander and less easy to achieve.
So you've been able to do this every week for quite a while now. Could you kind of take us through that creation process and how it starts, when you start thinking about it, when you start actually putting stuff down and recording it and editing it and stuff like that?
Yeah, sure. It usually involves waking up fairly early on a Sunday morning, sitting there with a blank piece of paper, unless I've got something like The Journeys of Pashbo, which is obviously set by the dates that Frodo was journeying. Aside from that, with the poems or the stories, I just sit there with a cup of coffee in one hand until I get this moment of inspiration, and then literally just write everything. And then from there, I will then film, sort of give a bit of thought for each. If we think around a sort of a poem, for instance, a little bit around where each of those various verses should be set, and then I'll film a whole load of footage in game, a lot more than what I actually need normally, and then edit it down from there. But I tend to use, in terms of the equipment I use something called Debut Video Capture software, and then just edit it with the inbuilt Windows Movie Maker. I know it's a fairly simplistic bit of software, but it works pretty well. I actually did spend quite a bit of money on getting some super duper video editing software, and I can't get my head around it, so I keep sort of shelving that and moving back to the Movie Maker.
Mm. So let me get this straight. You your entire creative process for An Unexpected Vidcast takes an entire day. Just one day.
Yeah.
You start on Sunday morning, you're done by Sunday night.
Yeah, usually I start it on Sunday morning. I've usually finished filming it. So I usually write in about an hour. Then the rest of it's sort of filming and editing. Usually finish that about 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And then it's a matter of uploading it onto YouTube and promoting it.
That's amazing. I've done a little bit of YouTube stuff in the past, and it's nothing as involved as what you've done, and it usually takes me more than a day to get that done. So I'm fairly amazed. That's really nice work.
And what you might notice is that, I mean, when we first started, it tended to be, each of the episodes tended to be about 20, 25 minutes. And I was finding that was just using up a lot of my week. As time's gone on, I've ended up just doing it on the Sundays and reducing the size of the episodes accordingly. But I fit in what I can in one day, really.
That's pretty good. So how do you keep your content fresh?
Hopefully I manage to. I do try to. It can be quite difficult sometimes. I think, like I said earlier on, I'm a fairly sort of imaginative person, and I tend to just use this sort of scattergun type approach, getting all of my ideas down on a bit of paper and building on works from there. But I think the other advantage I got, I think being that big fan of Tolkien's work, Turbine have done such a good job in actually bringing Middle-earth to life that there's such a vast amount of landmass there that you can keep the sort of scenery pretty varied, and therefore a lot of the ideas pretty varied as well. And I think when you take something like Hobbits, it's quite easy to keep the ideas flowing because their lives are so simple. You can sit and write a poem about anything, whether it's going on an adventure, going fishing, or the taste of an apple or something. You know, it's whatever, you can just look at anything in game really and think, oh, I can write a poem about that. So that's how I tend to work on it. But the big thing is going to be, what can I do that can actually capture people's imagination like the Big Burrow feature did? And I don't think I've quite done that yet again, but we'll see. I'm sure I'll come up with a few more ideas. Yeah.
So have you run into any limitations by doing this type of creative filmmaking?
Probably the biggest is that time element, because of a number of other commitments that I have. I tend to find it does tend to be limited to that Sunday. So all that Sunday is tends to be pretty full up with all that writing, the filming, uploading, etc. And I guess if I had more time, I would hope that I could do it a little bit better. But I think Turbines have presented such a great backdrop with that Locho game. That for a Tolkien level like myself is an absolute dream. I think the only limitation is that not all of Middle-earth is yet opened up. Mm-hmm. So at the moment I can't take it any further than Rohan. So for instance, if we look at the journeys of Pashbo, at the moment I've got as far as the end of the Fellowship of the Ring, and I could have taken him a little bit into Helm's Deep area, but I decided to sort of cut it at the end of the book. But I'd love to have been able to keep that segment going for a bit longer, but the landmass isn't there yet.
Yeah, we were kind of conjecturing on Lothar Player's News what you were going to do with the journey of Pashbo when you got to
I was listening to that
certain point that,
a chuckle. Yeah,
but I think what happened was you came up with a pretty ingenious way to get him to turn back at a place where you knew you couldn't go much further, and it was all part of the story, and it kind of worked really well.
It did, but that was I hadn't actually worked. I knew I was going to cut it at that point, but I was literally just going to bring it to an end and say, "Thus ends the first book of the Journeys of Pashbo." It wasn't until that Sunday morning when I just had that idea of bringing Ruby Ray and everything into it. So it worked quite well in the end. But yeah.
Now you don't do Ruby Ray's voice too, do you?
I don't know. I do a couple of the women voices on there.
Guy's gonna be really impressed if you could get your voice that high.
No, I didn't think anyone could. That's actually my wife does that one.
Oh, okay.
She tends to. She occasionally comes in and does the odd voice here and then. And she does actually. She sort of said, you know, I took all the credit earlier on for the poems. There have been a handful of those poems at different times. The ones she's voiced that she's written as well.
Okay.
So I haven't got the total monopoly on it.
So you're an artistic family.
Yeah, obviously I'm the most artistic. we all enjoy it, definitely.
Okay, Pash, so do you play any other games? And if you do, do you create content using those as well? Or is this strictly kind of a Lotro Tolkien thing?
In terms of the creating content, it's just Lotro. And I guess I'm a pretty total Lotro addict. Which you have to be, I think, don't you, to play that many alts and get them out of the starting zone as much as anything else. I've tried a few other games. I tried Rift for a while and I didn't like it at all. I just couldn't get any feeling from it. And similarly, I forgot what it's called now, but that Star Wars one, I just didn't do it for me.
Yeah, the Old Republic. Yeah.
The Dungeons and Dragons, I like the look of. I just wasn't very good at it, so I stopped playing that one. So I've been, you know, primarily focused on Lotro. I do play other games sometimes, some of the more puzzle-solving ones. I don't know whether you can get them over there, but there's a really good Sherlock Holmes, which is obviously very, very English, but good sort of Sherlock Holmes series you get over here. And there's one which was Sherlock Holmes versus Jack the Ripper, which was an absolutely fantastic game. And had some really great footage within it and was very close to a lot of the sort of facts of what people do know around the Ripper case and things. So, you know, you'll get this occasional game which will entice me in, but none that I've found myself leaning towards filming. So when Lotro eventually finishes, which will hopefully not be for some time, I'll be completely stumped. I'll have to think of something else then.
So is the allure of the creative process then partially that you are in this world of Tolkien, that you are in Middle Earth doing this?
Yeah, it is. Which is odd because, as I say, I think of myself as being fairly creative. So it's usually I'm not necessarily inspired by other people. I'll just write whatever I want to write. But there is something in itself just around that universe that Tolkien created. And as I say, the turbine I've really fantastically, I think, certainly in terms of the way the world looks and everything, they've really captured that brilliantly. So it is a really good inspiration. There's so much there to be able to get your teeth into, really, and still hopefully make it feel like it's yours, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
So as far as filmmaking goes, are you involved in any other kinds of filmmaking?
Well, I mentioned my son earlier on. He's 10. He's a huge Doctor Who fan. So, on Sundays is obviously an unexpected vidcast day, but most of Saturday is spent filming, you know, sort of stop motion like Doctor Who adventures using his action figures, and you know, being sort of 10, he gets all the best parts. I'm usually left with like the Monty Python-esque woman voices, so it'll have me sort of like, would you like spam, Doctor? You know, I get all those sort of things. Or maybe spam. So, you know, he gets all the cool parts. But I'm also a big Spaghetti Western fan.
Okay.
And myself and my best friend went on holiday to Almeria in Spain, which is where most of those films were made. And they still have a lot of the old film locations stand in there, and we made our own spaghetti western. So and I you know, the real observer might actually notice the very occasionally a little bit of that Sergio Leone-esque angles find their way into the vidcast.
But so I will have to say that you do a very good Catherine Tate, because I picked that up in one of Pash Bo Jr.'s one of his videos.
Yeah, that's a good example. You see, you know, that he'd never take on that role. But no, to be honest, though, it's brilliant. I love spending that time with him working on those films, and he's really passionate about it. I think he sees himself eventually as taking over An Unexpected Vidcast. I think when I retire from it, I think he wants to film the shoes. I think
the family fortune gets handed over.
That's right. Yeah.
I will say that I have followed some of Pash Bo Jr.'s films online, and if anybody out there is listening, it is a really acute thing to watch. And as somebody who has a 10-year-old, I guess now 11-year-old myself, I can really relate to spending that time with your children doing something that you both love. And so it really comes through in the video. You obviously have to keep in mind that it's coming from a 10-year-old mind, but it is really it's really something that if you have kids or if you know kids of that age, you'll be able to appreciate it, I think.
Yeah, no, that's good. The great thing is he's got so many ideas running around his head. I mean, he's always talking to me about, obviously with my own vidcast, of what I can do. You know, as I say earlier on, he's already got ideas for the next big burrow, but he's also thinks he's got plans on an unexpected vidcast, the movie, a big hour and a half epic, which he's going to work on with me at some point or other. So I'm not sure where we're going to fit in time for making that, but it's great to have him, you know, that keen and excited and that creative, to be honest.
Is he helping out in any of the technical aspects as well, or are you handling most of the technical stuff and he's doing kind of the production/director stuff?
He tends to do the writing for his own stuff. He tends to do the writing for that, and he'll tend to do the movement. Although we tend to work on that between us a little bit. The editing is all me, other than the voice elements of it, which he helps with getting those bits in place. But he gets that's the one thing. He gets a bit bored when it comes to the editing side of it, because that can take a little bit of time, can it? Sometimes he's always moving on to the next thing then.
So are you involved in other creative types of things that you'd wish to talk about?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I mean, I've always done a lot of writing. So whether it's the poems, obviously, I can tend to bring some of that out, at least anyway, within the vidcast. Always written a lot of stories. I'm, for my sins, the front man in an alternative rock band called Freak Circus over here, so which is great in itself. It gives me the opportunity to unwind by jumping around the stage like some once described as the sort of mutant son of Iggy Pop and Jarvis Cocker, which I thought was quite good. And I like writing music. I love melody, but my strength's always probably been more so around the words element of it. So I certainly write much better than I talk. But photography is another thing. I've got, particularly over the last couple of years, I've spent quite a bit of time doing photography, digital editing, anything really that can challenge my overactive imagination.
I was kind of hoping you'd bring up Freak Circus, because as I started doing research and doing some collaboration with you, it just blew me away that that Pash Bo Proudfeet was the front man of an alternative rock band.
Yeah, it's difficult to picture that, isn't it? Although it'd probably be even more frightening the other way around. So if people that follow the band found out that on a Sunday I sort of get out my brown slippers and put on a squeaky hobbit voice, it probably wouldn't do too much for me punk rock credibility, I don't think.
But that was what I mean. It was kind of a surprise, but at the same time, it's something that I understand well, because I do the same thing as far as, you know, the podcasting, the gaming, the writing, the blogging. I have a personal blog, you know, but I also have the Lotro Players blog, and then I also have Braxwolf's blog. So I do a lot of compartmentalizing myself, and so I understand what it's like to kind of have this aspect of my life, but also need this aspect as well, and not necessarily have the mix. So I appreciate that you brought it up and actually mixed them a little bit here, because I think it was it's an interesting point to bring up. And you know, we know people in the game as a fairly maybe single dimensional piece of what they really are.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of fun to learn some other aspects about them too.
Yeah. I mean, by the sounds of it, you're quite similar to me. So I have different aspects of my life and they're all very, very different. And I tend to generally not mix them up very much at all. So if I think about my, because unfortunately I have to have a day job as well, which takes up a fair amount of my time. But a few people will know a little bit about the band. I don't think anybody knows about the vidcast. You know, I tend to keep all of that sort of stuff secret from everyone because that's not the me that goes to work.
Right.
Yeah. So, I'm probably a little bit Jekyll and Hyde like that. I've got too many characters in addition to the 60 to 70 alts on the Lotro.
So, this is now we get into kind of the less personal questions maybe, and the more introspective. Very recently, YouTube has gotten into this idea of enforcing copyright, and I know because I'm a little bit involved in that community, and though not as much as like Andang or somebody like that, but I continually see these updates from YouTube saying, we're proactively looking for copyrighted material. I see people complaining about their stuff getting taken down because somebody's complained about copyrighted material. The other side of that argument is, well, this is actually fair use because I'm taking it and I'm editing it in a way so that it's now something different. Are you concerned about this fair use when it comes to an unexpected vidcast, or do you do things to kind of get around that?
I'd never really given it that much thought until a few weeks ago. And I think it's probably the first time it really affected me, which was when I can't remember which of the bands it was I featured, but it was one of the bands from Winterstock where I used some footage of them. And that was the first time I'd ever got a message come back saying, you know, warning, copyrighted material. And it didn't remove the video or anything, but it was the first time that flashed up. And it was complete surprise to me. So I have thought about it a little bit more since then. And certainly when I mentioned my lad's Doctor Who episodes, a number of his actually got flagged because of the use of the theme tune from Doctor Who. So now we tend to write our own music for it. So whereas before we tended to use music out of the episodes. These days we just create it from scratch ourselves and add it in that way.
Right.
And that seems to get around it. But I don't know, from a personal perspective, I guess it tends to be the music sort of side of it that I found to be an issue. I haven't found anything so far being flagged because of the actual the visual stuff that's being used.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I think the reason that your vidcast came to mind was that you do use some of the in-game music in your intro and I think throughout the episodes as well.
I do, all of the music that's in it, aside from the various Lotro bands that are included, it tends to all be off of the soundtrack from Lotro. I mean, I guess the other way of looking at it is I'm hoping that what I do in some way or other helps to encourage people to try the game out, and therefore in a way it's a bit of an advert for the game and Tolkien's work. But it depends how you look at it. I've not fallen foul of it yet. I'm hoping that I don't. We're gonna have to see, won't we?
It would be a little strange at this point, because I can remember I got the original Shadows of Angmar soundtrack because there was a link in the forums to a free download that Turbine had provided. So it would be a little bit strange now for them to turn around and say, you can't use this music that we freely gave to everybody. I'm sure it's certainly within their right, but it would be kind of a strange change of stance for them.
Yeah. It'd be an interesting one to see how I'd get around that. Because I say with the Doctor Who stuff that we do, we make our own music. But I can't say that I am a musician, I wouldn't be particularly great at coming up with music of the quality of Chance Thomas, I don't think. Not on a Sunday morning, anyway.
Yeah.
No, that'd probably be just pushing it a bit too far.
Yeah, in my awareness of this is what has kind of caused me. I came up with the music for this podcast using GarageBand because I'm always kind of wary about, even though I don't think it's quite a big of deal on podcasts right now, you never know when that type of thing is going to come up.
Yeah, and I think so. I mean, to be honest, if you look at the vidcast that I do, there's a number of people that watch it regularly, but it's still a relatively small fan base that it's got. And I guess the more popular things become, it becomes more and more of an issue, doesn't it?
And I think monetization might have something to do with that as well.
Yeah, sure.
Now to kind of bring us back to all the way back to where we started a long time ago in this conversation. Remember the Wired magazine article that I took a segment out of to begin with.
Sure, yeah.
Considering that and the obvious advances in technology bringing video game engines closer to the quality of CGI that's being used in filmmaking today, why do you think that Machinima hasn't taken off as predicted over 10 years ago?
And perhaps the biggest problem is that some of these games are just so addictive that it's hard to drag yourself away from them for long enough to make the film. Maybe that's got something to do with it. But I don't know. Although I've not found too many limitations, there are limitations in using somebody else's world, I think. Because immediately then it's not your own imagined area. You know, you're immediately using somebody else's source material, which is a limiter, I think, in some ways. I think the other thing perhaps is that filmmaking more generally, for those that are in the know, has got a lot easier to do full stop. So perhaps with the sort of technology that we're afforded with, there's not much need to be constrained by a particular game world. Personally, I love finding videos that have been made by the community. So, I mean, for instance, I think it was something that was on Lotcha Player's site, one of the music videos that Arcasio put together with the Shades. Mm-hmm. And I think you stumble across things like that, and it's fantastic. So I think, whilst I'm not necessarily convinced that this type of filmmaking will ever get as big as perhaps how Wired were predicting back in 2003, I think it will become and continue to be a very fan-based content, so a relatively small fan base, but hopefully sort of playing quite a vital role in that game's community.
I have a theory as well, and I don't, it's probably more of a recent phenomenon, but it's become so much easier just to do. Now, if you go out and do probably a Google search on video game movies,
yep,
you'll probably get pages of these let's plays and playthroughs that people are posting on YouTube. And now that people are kind of doing live on Twitch, it seems to be such an easier thing to do. If you're playing the game anyway, to flip a switch and say, now I'm streaming it, everybody come watch me play. It's so much easier to do that than it is to get up on Sunday morning, have a cup of coffee, and then spend your entire day coming up with a video to post.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. It's probably a more sensible answer than mine, actually. But I can see where you're coming from that, definitely.
I'm just wondering if that has had an effect. But like I said, this article that we read earlier was from 10 years ago, and really the streaming thing is a fairly recent phenomenon. So there's still a big gap there that doesn't explain exactly why it hasn't. I mean, they were talking about like in the next 2 or 3 years, they were thinking that Machinima was really going to be something that maybe even major studios use instead of spending millions of dollars on a Weta project or something like that.
Yeah,
and we just really haven't seen that. We're still seeing the big studios go with these proven companies that do really, really advanced types of animation and rendering and stuff like that. Yeah. So I think that's interesting. And I do wonder if at some point because we, now I'm going to back up a minute, because working in the IT world, we have what's called the Gartner hype cycle.
Right.
And I don't know if you're familiar with this, but it kind of goes in an upwards curve, and then it goes down into a trough. And basically, when you're at the peak, the pinnacle of that curve, that's when the hype for the technology is the highest. But the technology has not yet come to actual stable use yet.
Yeah, sure.
You know, there's all this talk about it, but it's not until it goes back down through the trough and then comes back up and levels off a little bit that it comes into everyday use. I wonder if we're just on a very, very long hype cycle for Machinima, and now we've kind of been sitting in the trough of disillusionment, and we're we're waiting for that that upward swing where video games now are literally, the graphics are good enough and your home PC is powerful enough to render something that looks very similar to what you'd see in a Lord of the Rings movie from the year 2000 or whatever.
It could be. I think probably what it is that everybody's waiting for that An Unexpected Vidcast, the movie. I think that's what it is. It's holding back, waiting for that.
That's the breakthrough. That's gonna bring all the spotlight back on Machinima, and then we're gonna have major studios calling Freak Circus and saying, "We want you in our movie."
That's right. That'll happen, and I'll have to do whole interviews in the Pash Boo voice. Yeah, it could be.
I'm kind of glad you didn't do that. I like Pash Boo a lot, but I'm kind of glad you didn't do that, because I want you to be able to talk tomorrow.
Yeah, no, definitely. It could have been even worse, actually, if Ruby Ray had been doing the interview. Usually the sort of four or five lines that usually does it for the whole of the day. She can't speak after doing that. It's interesting, because you mentioned about the streaming. I hadn't actually really watched that much of those streams until about a month ago, when Turbine started doing the Friday night Taking the Hobbits to Isengard stuff, and that was the first time I'd actually sat down and watched a live stream of everything. It was great. Mm. Yeah, it's really, really quite interesting, but. Yeah, not got into that previously.
I like it when they do developer streams where they have people on doing Q&As and things like that. I'm on record as saying I still don't really get the appeal of watching another player go through a game and not say anything interesting.
Yeah, no, I'd be the same. But they probably also, I guess, looking at it from the other way around, these people that are enjoying that probably don't want to hear somebody talking in a squeaky hobbit voice reading a poem about apples, I guess.
There's
probably a bit of each to their own, isn't it?
There's probably a point there, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, that brings us to the feedback section of the show, and I actually had a couple pieces of feedback to share. My friend Randolph has written in again, and he had some interesting things to say. Our conversation last month was with American Golden Star, and it was about family life balance. And he talks a little bit here about some of the things he does to kind of keep his life in balance, and it made me chuckle a little bit. First of all, he said, "It was nice catching up with American Golden Star. I'm glad you had them on the show. Not sure how this pertains to your gaming life balance topic, but I've recently undertaken a shift in my own gaming habits. For about 5 years, I played exclusively PC games, mainly MMOs, while my Xbox 360 gathered dust. These days, it's the opposite. We have our 360 set up in our bedroom where I manage to walk on a treadmill whenever I want to play a game. I wasn't sure I was going to be able to pull this off, as I'm not the most coordinated individual in the world, but it really hasn't proven that difficult. Now I can game and get some exercise at the same time. Two birds with one stone, you might say. My play sessions generally last anywhere from 30 to 90 minutes, and when I put down the controller, I've actually broken a sweat. So far, so good. I've lost a bit of weight, which isn't a bad thing for me, and I've managed to play through a couple of excellent games in the process, Dragon Age 2 and Diablo 3. So
he's got to be some kind of superhero to manage both these things at the same time.
That's exactly what I was thinking. And honestly, if you're walking for 90 minutes, that's really pretty good. I mean, you're getting a pretty decent workout if you're walking between 60 and 90 minutes, because I've been doing some running and walking here lately. And one thing that I learned, and this is interesting to me, this is a side note, walking will burn the same amount of calories as running the same distance. It just takes longer to do it.
Yeah.
So I thought that was kind of cool. So yeah, walking is good exercise. And by the way, he's still getting his game on.
Yeah, that's fantastic, isn't it?
He said, I also found it interesting how you managed to game together with your children as they've gotten older. That's something I'm still experimenting with my six-year-old son. He really enjoys Skylanders. Thankfully, that's a game I enjoy too. We'll play together from time to time, but as of yet, we really haven't found any other games that have stuck with him. I'm guessing that's an age thing at this point. 6 years old, yeah, that's an age thing. Sometimes I wonder, though. My father's passion was yard work. I tend to spend as little time as possible in our own yard. Is Randolph me? He says, perhaps my son will rebel against his old man and be out in the yard every chance he gets. We'll see, I guess. Randolph, I don't think so. I think if you put a controller in this kid's hand, he's going to sit next to you and play. I don't think he's going to run out of the yard and start mowing.
Most definitely. Yeah.
But thanks for writing in again, Randolph. I always enjoy hearing from you. This week or this month, we also had my first iTunes review, and I'm going to read that now as well. This is from Brewster of Brandywine, who's also written into Lotro Players. And thanks, Brewster, for following me over here. I really appreciate the feedback. Brewster says, I sat and listened to episode number 3. This was my first listen to Beyond Boss Fights. Lots of fun, nicely organized, quality content. Good job. I would ask that if anybody else out there enjoys any of this content, that could you also leave me some feedback on iTunes, because that actually does help people discover the podcast. I think if you get 5 reviews or star ratings, it starts showing up as having a star rating in the iTunes directory. So that always helps people who are trying to discover content about gaming and stuff like that. So I would appreciate anything you could do for me there. Also, if you would like to provide me with feedback, you can send it to braxwolf@gmail.com and I'll read it on the podcast. Wanted to also remind you that Beyond Boss Fights is now on Stitcher. So you can, if you've got an Android device and you can't use the iTunes Apple Store, then go ahead and you could use Stitcher. And that's another way you can get the podcast. Pash, I really want to thank you for being on. I knew that I was going to learn something when you came on today. I love hearing people's artistic and creative process, and it's been a real pleasure.
It's been a pleasure for me. It's been brilliant. If a bit daunting, following American Golden Star as the next one. I feel a little bit like One Direction following the Beatles. But it's been great fun. It's been a pleasure to talk to you.
You held your own just fine. Yeah. How can people get a hold of you, Pash?
Okay, a number of channels really. Obviously, An Unexpected Vidcast tends to appear on a weekly basis on Lotro Players News, so people can contact, not Lotro Players News, on the Lotro Players website, so people can contact through that website. Also, anunexpectedvidcast.weebly.com, tend to post most of the videos on there. There's a Twitter account, which is just @PashBoProudFeet, a YouTube account, which is An Unexpected Vidcast, and also a Facebook page, which is pashbo.proudfeet. And hopefully one or other of these channels, you should be able to contact me if you want to. Maybe give me some good ideas of the sorts of things I can include. And actually, if anyone actually wants to feature any footage or any segments in the vidcast, I'd love to hear from people. So I'd really like to be able to engage more in the community than perhaps I do at the moment.
Excellent. Get a hold of them if you've got a band that you'd like to promote on Unexpected Vidcast or anything else creative that you'd like to do. I know Pash is always open.
Yeah, definitely.
And as for me, you can follow me on Twitter @BraxWolf, BraxWolf. You can email me at braxwolf@gmail.com. I've got a Facebook and YouTube account. You can find those on Google if you want. And my blog is now at braxwolf.com. I have registered my own domain, so now it's even easier to find my writings and the podcast. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in, and we will see you next month. Thank you.